Good evening. Please stand and join together in singing By Our Love. By our love, by our love, they will know we are Christians by our love, not by words, but how we live. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Son of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace and peace of God our Father who raised Jesus from the dead be with you all.
Your spirit.
These last weeks of the Easter season, as we prepare to celebrate the ascension of the Lord and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, our scriptures tonight calls us to be open, to continue to be amazed by the wonders of the Lord, how the risen Christ continues to transform creation, most especially by his radical call to genuine and sincere love. Mindful of the times that our hearts and minds have not been open, that we've not been responsive to that call, my brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries. You have revealed to the nations the saving power of God. Lord, have mercy. You are God's love sent into the world that we might have life. Christ, have mercy. You no longer call us slaves, but friends. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, Heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. Grant, Almighty God, that we may celebrate with heartfelt devotion these days of joy, which we keep in honor of the risen Lord, and that what we live in remembrance, we may always hold on to in what we do. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When Peter entered, Cornelius met him and, falling at his feet, paid him homage. Peter, however, raised him up, saying, "Get up, I myself am also a human being." Then Peter proceeded to speak and said, "In truth, I see that God shows no partiality. Rather, in every nation, whoever fears him and acts uprightly is acceptable to him." While Peter was still speaking these things, the Holy Spirit fell upon all who were listening to the word. The circumcised believers who had accompanied Peter were astounded that the gift of the Holy Spirit should have been poured out on the Gentiles also, for they could hear them speaking in tongues and glorifying God. Then Peter responded, "Can anyone withhold the water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit even as we have?" He ordered them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter of St. John. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is of God. Everyone who loves is begotten by God and knows God. Whoever is without love does not know God, for God is love. In this way, the love of God was revealed to us. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might have life through him. In this is love. Not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as expiation for our sins. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Brothers and sisters, the Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "As the Father loves me, so I also love you. Remain in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and your joy might be complete. This is my commandment: love one another as I love you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I no longer call you slaves because a slave does not know what his master is doing. I've called you friends because I've told you everything I've heard from my Father. It was not you who chose me, but I who chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit that will remain, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give you. This I command you: love one another." The Gospel of the Lord. When was the last time you experienced or witnessed mind-blowing generosity? Far too often, members of Generation Z, those who were born between 1995 and 2012, are described in pretty unflattering ways. Perhaps everyone feels that way about their generation when they're being evaluated by those who are older. But having worked with college students now for close to 14 years, one of the many joys has been seeing some of the most beautiful examples of sincere generosity that's been mind-blowing to me. Like when on a midnight run where we were bringing food and clothing and toiletries to homeless men and women a couple years ago in New York City, and seeing the students hugging and praying with these strangers was beautiful in itself. But even going beyond that, this one particular night when we happened to be on a stop in Midtown Manhattan, and by that point we had started to run out of some supplies, which often happens. You have no idea how many people you're going to encounter, and the objective is just to do the best you can. And this one homeless man was very patiently standing online as those before him were being shown what was still available in terms of coats and sweaters and boots. And one of our students saw the guy standing there, and he just went over and asked him, was there anything in particular he was looking for? He was going to try to look for a size and stuff. And he said all he wanted were some new socks. And of all the things that we had left at that point, that was the one thing we were out of. And at that, the student said, give me a minute, just stay here. And then he bolted before I could stop him and say, what are you doing? Where are you going? Reminding we have a schedule to follow and blah, 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 blah. Before a word was out of my mouth, the kid ran and he went to a department store that was still open and bought a package of socks for this person. I think this is actually the first time I ever shared the story. I was just blown away on so many levels by the whole experience. Another example was one of our Focus missionaries. Focus is the Fellowship of Catholic University Students, and missionaries are recent college graduates who fundraise their salaries in order to minister to students. That in and of itself is mind-blowing, especially imagining some of the parents' reactions when they tell them after 4 years of college they're going to be begging for funds so they can lead their peers in Bible studies and hopefully have a deeper personal relationship with Jesus and his church. Some of their parents think it's mind-blowing, but not necessarily in a positive way. So I've been moved and humbled by these missionaries for over the 10 years they've been part of our ministry. And one missionary a few years back, his team member said to me, guess who on our team is donating a kidney and wasn't planning on telling anyone? And I did correctly guess. I knew exactly who it was. And when I was able to get the story out of him, which he sincerely did not want to share, lest he get any recognition or accolades for it, he explained the guy he went to high school, his kidney wasn't working, and he needed a transplant. So he went and got checked and found he was a perfect match and just offered it. He wasn't a relative, he wasn't even a close friend. And this missionary hadn't discussed it with his family when he made this decision to donate it. And had he not needed some time off for recuperation, he probably would never even shared it with his teammates. We kept it secret that he even knew about the surgery and this generous gift. And the day after the surgery was done, I went to visit him in the hospital. And he was so surprised and was very embarrassed that I was there and found out what he was doing. And so I said to him, I brought you something I thought you might need, at which point I brought out a can of kidney beans. And he started laughing, and he's grabbing his side in pain. I'm like, oh, does it hurt to laugh? Well, good. I'm helping you to grow in holiness, because now you can offer that up as well. While there's countless examples that demonstrate people's selflessness and their thoughtfulness and how they're living out their faith, those are just two experiences that radically stay out in my mind as sincerely being mind-blowing. They weren't just moving and profound examples of how these kids heard the gospel message and were trying to respond to it, but they humbled and challenged me to ask, what limits and why do I put limits in my response to being generous and responding to the gospel? And that's kind of what's happening in today's scriptures, especially starting with that first reading from the Acts of the Apostles. We need a few more details to understand how utterly mind-blowing a passage this was. For Peter, and as they're described in that reading, the circumcised believers, in other words, fellow Jews, this is after Jesus' ascension into heaven and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on them on Pentecost. So they've been sent by Jesus to share the gospel message to the ends of the earth. And the apostles' expectation, though, as lifelong Jews whose vision had been shaped by the scriptures of the Old Testament and their appreciation of being God's chosen people, was that they needed to get all the Jews to recognize Jesus as the Messiah, as the one who was to come. And that the restoration that they all were longing for, this kingdom, was far greater and of more eternal significance than any of them had imagined, as they experienced the resurrection of Jesus Christ being risen from the dead. All that was enough for them just to try to wrap their minds around. But their initial focus had been preaching and baptizing fellow Jews. So in that reading today, when this non-Jewish pagan, this Roman military official named Cornelius, comes to Peter and he's looking to be baptized, the circumcised believers were kind of debating, what did this mean? What do we do? How do we handle this? Does he need to be circumcised and become Jewish first? And that's when they witnessed the Holy Spirit coming upon these non-Jews. For Peter and the others, once again, they're astounded by what God was doing. Their minds were blown. Their visions were completely recast as they continue their apostolic missions, recognizing on a deeper and broader level all that Jesus had taught, particularly how Jesus was calling all humanity to be saved through him as the way, the truth, and the life. And that probably made the remembrances of the Last Supper and Jesus' dialogue with them in this gospel even more profound. When Jesus had first said these in the hours before Good Friday, they're gathering for what they thought was going to be just their celebration of Passover, as the triumph of Jesus being welcomed on Palm Sunday still resonated in their minds. They're somewhat blind and they're not paying attention to Jesus' warnings about what was to come, the chaos, the confusion of the unjust arrest and trial and torture and death of Jesus. And even though he had tried to prepare them for that and to anticipate his rising from the dead, those were things that they couldn't understand or appreciate yet. Now, post-Easter, they're able to revisit everything in light of Jesus being risen from the dead. And all this is utterly amazing. But Jesus simplified things in that passage where he calls them and us who keep his commandments, not merely followers, not just students or disciples. We're not lowly creatures or slaves of a divine creator, but something far more mind-blowing, friends. Maybe because that term has been so cheapened or watered down, we kind of lose how truly radical that is. God, who doesn't need anything or anyone, wants and desires us. He calls us not simply to follow the commandments out of obedience as creator of the universe would have every right and expectation to have, but he personalizes it and wants an intimate relationship, a friendship with us. That good news has to move us as well as humble and challenge us in asking, how will we respond? Because if we truly want that friendship, St. John, in his letter to in the second reading and in recounting that Last Supper dialogue in the gospel, tells us how, and that's love. Granted, that's another word that in our world where feelings are treated as paramount, it's no wonder people not only have misunderstood and confused by that call, but by the very word itself. I mean, we have McDonald's saying that in response to a quarter pounder with cheese and fries, I'm loving it. No, you might crave it. You might enjoy it, at least when you're first eating it. I don't know about you, a few minutes after eating McDonald's, I'm not loving it. I'm usually regretting it. But for us as Christians, when the truth of these terms are understood and lived, when friendship and when love is understood in light of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, and has lived from that vision of faith, we recognize how diminished those contemporary definitions of those words and terms really are. For Jesus, love is quite simply, but profoundly, selfless and sacrificial and life-giving. And we can recognize the difference in that and someone enjoying a fast food meal. We're moved to wonder and awe at the most authentic examples and expressions, whether it's a student on a midnight run buying socks, a missionary donating his kidney to an acquaintance, or all the women of our nation that we honor this weekend on Mother's Day, whose life and example through bearing us, bringing us to birth, raising us, embody and demonstrate the very nature of love. We're being challenged to ask, in what ways have we limited our response to the gospel? How have we held Jesus at a distance in our relationship with us personally? May we take comfort in these scriptures today to recognize how God is constantly trying to blow our minds and to expand our hearts, to experience authentic love and genuine friendship. Please stand. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men, for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate in the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead, life for the world to come. Amen. Let us pray for the needs of all the faithful.
For the journey of newly initiated Catholics this Easter, that the Word of God may always be a light to their path, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For healing and strength for all those who suffer illness or injury, and the intercession of Our Lady of Lourdes, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For health, for life, and eternal life and joy, for our mothers, godmothers, and grandmothers, living and deceased, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our beloved deceased, Anne Ayanna Cohn, Gary Grosso, Margaret Dangler, Carla Matarazzo, Nelson Munfiglio, Zal Velez, Rosina Yaleggio, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intention of this Mass, for the eternal rest of Michael Strollo, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, hear these prayers and those we keep in the silence of our hearts, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
There is a place for the sadness. Hold on to a season of gladness. Hold on to love. When pain and confusion seems endless, hold on to love. We cultivate healing through kindness. Hold on to love. To love where hope is found. Hold on to love where joy abounds. Hold on to love where grace and mercy is overflowing.
When terror and fear overwhelm us, hold on to love. Courage and faith will sustain us. Hold on to love. When violence seeks to destroy us, hold on to love. Acts of compassion restore us. Hold on to love. Hold on to love where love is found. Hold on to love where joy abounds. Hold on to love where grace and mercy is overflowing. Hold on to love.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. Accept the sacrifice at your hands, the praise and glory of his name, for our good and of all his holy church. May our prayers rise up to you, O Lord, together with the sacrificial offerings, so that purified by your graciousness, we may be conformed to the mysteries of your mighty love, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation at all times, to acclaim you, O Lord. But in this time above all, to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For with the old order destroyed, a universe cast down is renewed, and integrity of life is restored to us in Christ. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you've created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. This is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial, the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May you make of us an eternal offering to you so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope, Joseph our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you've summoned before you. In your compassionate, merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we wait the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
In the power and glory of God. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who will live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Of
Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. Only say the word, and my soul shall be. Thank you. Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, who restore us to eternal life in the resurrection of Christ, increase in us, we pray, the fruits of this Paschal sacrament, and pour into our hearts the strength of this saving food, through Christ our Lord.
Thank you to all of you for your support and prayers, helping to make the visit of our Archbishop, Cardinal Tobin, so wonderful, a blessing for our parish. Many of you attended Mass on Saturday evening, last weekend, and again on Sunday at 11:30 a.m., and Cardinal Tobin was very pleased to be with us, and we're pleased he could be here, and he said that we were very easy to work with, so you got that in your favor, too. Okay, thank you, as always.
On this Mother's Day weekend, let us take a moment to pray for all of our mothers, our grandmothers, for all of our baptismal godmothers, and for the women of faith in our lives, living and deceased. And I ask all of our moms to bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. Loving God, as a mother gives life and nourishment to her children, so you watch over your church. Bless these women, that they may be strengthened as models of confidence in you and as Christian mothers. Let the example of their faith and love shine forth. Grant that we, their sons and daughters, may honor them always with a spirit of profound respect. Grant this through Christ our Lord. Happy Mother's Day to all of you. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go forth, the Mass is ended.